Welcome, welcome, everybody. My name is Pippa Yates, and I'm one of the co-founders of Turn.io. And we exist to scale effective support to people everywhere. And so very warm welcome to Town Hall this October. I think, I don't know about you, but we've all been in a bit of shock over the last couple of days of what the violence that is happening in Gaza. And we just wanted to say that, if you have any loved ones or working with organizations who are active in the area, we are thinking of you. We are also ready to support as Turn in any way we can. That's a core tenet of this organization and why we exist, is to scale support in these types of scenarios. And so please do reach out and let us know if there's any way we can support you, all the organizations you work with or for or in partnership with. But I must say, we've been building an emergency response line to be ready to launch with any willing partner. And even though it's such sad conditions, I've been really lucky to be one of the first users of some of our new tooling that the product team's going to speak to you about today, which makes these types of support services way faster and way more easy for us non-technical folks to launch in these types of scenarios. So I'm pretty excited about what the product team is going to be sharing with you today. And then we've also got a very, very special guest on the call, Amrita, who's going to be telling us all about what the amazing team at Aman is doing with the Kulkari program in India, supporting mothers. And so I'm not going to give you any of her secrets away, but very excited to have her with us today to share all of the learnings around, reaching mothers at enormous scale that is needed in India and what their plans are there. And of course, we have a lot of amazing community news this month. So I'm going to hand over to Gustav to welcome some of the new community members to chat for Impact.
Thanks, Pippa, and thanks everybody. As always, just super inspiring to see the amazing organizations that we're working with. Echoing what Pippa said, we are shocked and horrified by what's going on in Gaza. We, as she said, we exist to help scale support to people everywhere, no matter where they live. I think a lot of us started working together with you guys during COVID, obviously the support program in Afghanistan and Ukraine, and we hope to be able to extend that into Gaza as well. But that's why we exist. That's why most of you exist as well, is to use technology to scale this type of support. So I'm very excited to, every month, this is one of my favorite parts, to read the descriptions of the organizations that are onboarding and that are building their new services. So this month we've got a really cool geographic distribution of organizations. From the UK is 10 Milligram Pharma. They are a very interesting, a responsible supply chain organization focusing on chronic medications in Africa, which we know is a huge issue, not just in Africa, but then generally speaking in low resource communities. They have over 1,000 healthcare providers that they're supporting, and using an AI-based platform and our platform to help communicate with their stakeholders. Judah is from South Africa, our home, or my ex-hometown, but certainly the country that I'm based in, and they're building out a new generation medical record system, which will be patient-controlled, not provider-controlled, which I think is a really interesting and important road that we need to go on in empowering end users and patients. Then from Brazil is Layers, who are education-focused organization. And they are building relationships between parents, teachers, and managers, and really excited to see what they're going to be doing. CRU is a faith-based organization. Blue Room Care is another very exciting mental telehealth provider out of Nigeria, and they are using WhatsApp to empower their platform and empower patients to book their consults, and also to be able to communicate with their patients. And then finally, Instituto Caldeira is out of Brazil, and they're a nonprofit institute that built a hub to connect organizations, social impact organizations together. So welcome to these organizations. I'm really excited to see the work that they're going to be doing, and I'm really happy to see the geographic distribution of all these platforms. And then obviously, as if you were on the town halls the last couple of months, we just concluded our demo day last month for the accelerator, and I'm going to hand over to Lisa to speak a little bit about that.
Thanks, Gustav. Well, I had the immense privilege of working very closely with 10 amazing organizations for the last 7 weeks. It all culminated into a demo day, which was really amazing. We will be sharing the video link to that, to the individual videos as well, where you can go and see what these organizations did. But just to give you a brief overview of who joined us on demo day, the room is filled with funders and media, but most importantly, our VIP guests, the 10 organizations that went through this accelerator. So we from Kenya, we had Access Afia, who provide localized primary healthcare to low-income markets. From Pakistan, we had Aga Khan University focusing on health and institution building, specifically in the developing world. Cranberry Fit from India, amazing service helping women with managed period pain and PMS through a chat-based coaching service. We had from Nigeria, Help Mum, they're utilizing to support nursing mothers and the whole maternal journey for mothers. Impulsa.gov from Brazil, they work with local healthcare professionals and provide them with technology and preventative care via WhatsApp. From the US and also globally as COCO, a very important service, especially in the times now. And they're addressing youth mental health services through AI. And also you can see what their service looks like on WhatsApp. We had Rocket Health from Uganda, who's delivering telemedicine and last mile services in Uganda. And then from Ecuador, we had Vida Plena, who's offering evidence-based depression treatment as well through a cost-effective therapy model. And then lastly, from India as well, we had Wiser, and they provide 24/7 accessible and affordable mental health support via WhatsApp. So a real global footprint of organizations. I would really recommend that you take the time out to look at the videos. They are really inspiring, and maybe you could be one of the next accelerators winners. So keep an eye out. We will be sharing some interesting and exciting news in the near future. Over to Ricardo to chat us through some of the product updates.
Thanks, Lisa. Hi, everyone. My name is Ricardo. I'm from the product team here at Turn, and I'm happy to be with you today. We have a lot of exciting things to talk about, so let's dive into it. Next slide, please. First, on the build side of the product, we've been working hard to make it easier and faster to build new features into your service. We redesigned the blocks of the no-code canvas from the ground up, and besides making it easier to use, we also added a ton of new features such as adding media to any message block, easily switching between block types, giving you better feedback on how long your message should be, and much, much more. This is launching now, and we can't wait to see what you build. Next slide, please. On the human-to-human side of the product, we've solved the hard issue that we know was affecting many of you, being interrupted by the bot while you're helping someone. So here's a quick video on how it works. Next slide. Hey, it's Ricardo from Turn here. We made some important changes to your inbox, and we'd love to tell you about it. You know when you're having a conversation with someone, and based on something that person said, the chatbot automatically sends a message and it interrupts you. When this happens throughout the conversation, it can get really annoying, right? So from now on, as soon as you send your first message, you can see that this button now has changed and it says reply and take over from the bot. What this does is that it pauses the bot until you're done helping that person. You can see here on the bottom that the bot is now paused and you can just continue chatting with that person until you're done. When you're done, you just close the ticket as usual, and we automatically reactivate the bot. You can see that the bar is now turning green. You can also see that we send a couple of automated messages to the conversation thread. This helps the user know that they're done chatting with you and that they can now chat with the bot again. These automated messages that go out to the user can be edited by going to the content area of Tern, filtering by the label automated messages, and then you can find them all here. Just click and edit and change it to whatever you like. This is very helpful when you provide your service in multiple languages, for example, or you want to make them your own. Another cool feature that we created is that in your flows, you can now route a conversation to an operator. So if a person is interacting with a chatbot and at some point they want to chat with a person, which you could give them as an option through a button, for example, we have a new route to operator block, which would immediately route that conversation to a person. There's a bunch of different ways you can configure this to tailor this to your service. That's it. We hope you like this as much as we do. And this is it. This video is also going to show up on the product itself because it's really important that your team gets onboarded into this new way of working. This is launching now as well, and we'd love to hear your feedback. Over to you, Nilka.
Oh, thanks, Ricardo. I'm very excited about both those new launches. I think you guys will enjoy it a lot. And yeah, you can expect to see it on your Tern instance at the end of today. I want to share two features that are we've been talked about for a whole long time, and they are now both in testing. So this is more of a shout out if you want to get in on the early fun and give us feedback and help shape it until we launch it to all. The first one is what we call the reimagined inbox. So the first version is being tested, and if you're especially if you're on a help desk and you want to get access to it, let me know. On my email, I'll share that in the chat. This is really centered around the operator. The layout has changed. We're working on things like bulk editing action. So a whole bunch of stuff to make your team work faster and smoother together. The new inbox also becomes the foundation of the routing engine. That will only launch later in the year, but we want to get your feedback on the changes we've made to date. So let me know. And then the second one, I think there's going to be a whole bunch of excitement around this, that we're adding triggers to the canvas, right? And we're specifically starting with time-based triggers. So think about you want to send a weekly message, right? Or you want to send a notification after a specific action has happened. Or maybe you just want to wish people happy birthday, right? So this and much more can now be done with triggers on the canvas. We will also soon move over your message-based triggers, so things triggering on keywords. And that means that your stack journey really runs end-to-end on the canvas. So be in contact with me if your team wants to test this out, give us feedback, make sure it works as expected, and yeah, share whatever else you would want on that. I would love to hear from you guys and get that hooked up for your team. And then lastly, from my side, I also just want to more of an announcement. We are moving to an improved billing system. What it practically means is that future invoices will look a little bit different. So I want to talk about it here because we will send emails and inform all the billing contacts. But I think it's always better if you hear these things from the team directly. So future invoices will come from Paddle. That will be our merchant of record going forward. And a key change is that you will be paying Paddle going forward. So there's some banking implications around that. But the really exciting part is this also comes with more payment options. So there will be more ways that you can pay your licensing fee. And ultimately, it will also give you more control over your account. So you'll be able to update stuff like your billing address and switch between a monthly or annual plan. So a whole bunch of excitement going, coming. But I just want to say that you guys, when you see Paddle and you see invoices coming from Paddle on behalf of Tern, that you know that, yeah, it's intended and that will be the future. Any questions, you obviously very welcome to reach out to us. And then I'm handing over to Simon.
Yes. So last month, I was at the Conversations Conference in Mumbai. And WhatsApp demoed what was called Flows. It looked like it went very quickly. I don't know if we can play that video again. And what it does is it allows you to design flows that run natively on the phone itself. And the demo here is capturing a booking, for example. We've all struggled over the years with how to best design a service or a user experience that captures structured data, for example, like birthdays, or how to upload an image or things like that. Now, WhatsApp's native flows allow you to send those types of data capturing or demographic capturing flows straight to the phone and have them be completed on the phone in one single interaction. And we're very excited about this. And what's very nice about this is that once this is deployed to the phone and the person answers their demographic question, say for an opt-in or an onboarding or a health check-in, you name it, then you can tie those things again into the larger experiences that you have designed on your canvas. So this is coming. We're very excited about it. They announced it last month. It was just made available a few days ago. And so we're racing to make this available to you all. Next slide, please. So for those of you who are with us over the years, will remember that way in the beginning of the WhatsApp Business API, groups were actually supported. And about 2 years ago, WhatsApp decided to reevaluate the use case and the specific implementation, and then it was removed from the offering. And we were all quite sad about that because there were so many great use cases for groups, specifically in the social impact space. Just think about peer support groups or pregnancy groups, birthing groups, you name it. And so we're very excited to be able to say that WhatsApp is again starting to re-implement or make available groups on the business API. The exact details of how that will work are still a little bit unclear. But if you have specific use cases where you're thinking about groups, we would love to hear about them because it is clearly something that's coming down the pipeline of the WhatsApp Business API. And once it is, we will again make it available in turn to all of you social impact organizations like we were able to do a few years ago. So we're very, very excited about that. And lastly, is another announcement that came out of the conference in Mumbai, which is what Meta is calling their AI experiences. And what we are seeing is that there's a broad push in Meta to introduce AI and large language models across all of their platforms. And so they've introduced this idea of Meta AI assistance on Messenger, which introduces personas that you can talk to about specific subjects. And the demos cover things like talking about sports or entertainment or a cooking show or things like that. And we're part of the early access program to also introduce these things for WhatsApp specifically. So we're not quite sure yet of the exact details, but we're very excited to be part of the program. And the use cases that we're thinking about here is like, what would an AI assistant on WhatsApp look like for specific health use cases? For example, a primary healthcare practitioner or a community health worker. So as we develop this program and as we work with Meta on these things, we will share these results, the results with you all in Town Hall. So we're very excited about all of these future things that are coming down the line that we're involved with, and we'll be making available to you all, the wider community, as soon as we can. With that, I hand over to Gustav.
Great. As always, we love to celebrate community successes and where organizations on our platform are going. So we're going to take you a little bit through two exciting bits of news. So firstly, if you might recall, eCubed, that was launched during COVID, I think in 2020, as part of the COVID response. They've got strength from strength to strength over the last couple of years. It's now the national system supported by the, or at least in support of the national educational system in South Africa. And we're very happy to celebrate the success that they've been selected to go and present at the Aspen Institute. And they're competing on the Digital Equity Accelerator programs, which is supporting 10 not-for-profit organizations, the NGOs working to reduce the opportunity gap. So we wish them luck there. I think their pitch is actually right now, or it was yesterday. So we really hope to get in, and obviously doing amazing work there and supporting the teachers and educational system in South Africa. And then the next one, Sweet Life is doing incredible work. They're a community-based organization here in South Africa working on diabetes management, and they have been selected as one of the three finalists and competing in Switzerland. So they will be pitching there. They're going to a week-long boot camp and they're competing for a $100,000 prize. So congratulations on the work there. Very important work on chronic medication, diabetes specifically, and hopefully a model that will scale throughout other countries that we are supporting. And now I'm very excited to hand over to Manish to talk to an incredible program that's working in India that Manish has been supporting, and really excited to hear more about them. Over to you, Manish.
Thanks, Gustav. Hello, everyone. I am Manish Manohar. I am a solutions engineer at Tern, and I'm very happy to be here today. In today's community showcase, I'm delighted to introduce Amrita from Amran. Amrita is the Director of Product and Innovation at Amran, where she drives the project vision, strategy, and product roadmap for the next generation versions of Kilkari and Mobile Academy programs, two of the largest mHealth programs in the world, targeting pregnant women and frontline health workers. Amrita is a qualified rocket scientist with degrees in aerospace and aeronautics from Stanford University and the Indian Institute of Technology, Mumbai. She is also a published author. Welcome, Amrita, and we are thrilled to have you here with us today. To kick off this interview, Amrita, tell us more about what Arman, the organization, does, and specifically your portfolio working on Kilkari and Mobile Academy program that you lead.
Yeah, thank you, Manish. It's a pleasure to be here. Arman is an India-based nonprofit that works in maternal and child health with a focus on preventive care. We leverage technology and existing health worker networks to reduce maternal and child mortality through two kinds of programs. One, programs that empower women with critical preventive care information through pregnancy and infancy, which enables them to seek care in time. And two, programs that train and support health workers to identify high-risk conditions early and manage them more effectively. And we have multiple programs under both categories, but the two largest programs are Kilkari and Mobile Academy. These are Ministry of Health programs that Arman manages. They're both IVR-based offerings, and in the last 5 years, they've reached over 40 million women.
Amazing, 40 million. It's quite a scale. Building on that, Amrita, I would like to understand more about your programs. Who is your intended audience from Kilkari and Mobile Academy programs, and what strategies do you employ to connect with them?
Sure. So Kilkari is a preventive care service for pregnant women and mothers of infants. So the information service starts in the fourth month of pregnancy and goes on till the child turns one. That's about 18 months of content. Mobile Academy is a refresher training course for a cadre of frontline health workers called ASHAs. And there are over a million ASHAs in the country. And Kilkari and Mobile Academy are currently available in 18 states in India and will be available pan-India by the end of next year. And because these are Ministry of Health programs, we are plugged into the National Registry of Pregnancies and Births, which is the RCH portal. So that means that when a woman gets pregnant and she goes to a government health facility, or when a child is born, the information goes into RCH. And if the woman happens to be in one of the 18 states where Kilkari is available, she automatically starts receiving Kilkari calls. Similarly, for Mobile Academy, we are plugged into the National Health Worker Registry. So in the 18 states where the service is available, the ASHA can access the service from her registered phone number. That said, we are also exploring new enrollment mechanisms. So we are looking at working with other NGOs with grassroots presence. We are looking at working with community-based organizations and also allowing self-registration. We have a focus on equity in all of our programs. So we want to make sure that we have customized offerings for women who get left out of the formal health system.
Amazing. Shifting gears here, Amrita, you recently wrapped up a pilot study introducing Kilkari on WhatsApp. Could you please provide insights into the findings from this pilot study and how you envision WhatsApp being integrated into your programs going forward?
Our overall vision for the coming years is to go from these one-size-fits-all audio-only offerings to richer, more personalized multimedia products. This applies to both Kilkari and Mobile Academy. And this is what we call Kilkari Mobile Academy 2.0. And one of the key pillars of Kilkari Mobile Academy 2.0 is WhatsApp as a delivery channel. And there are a few reasons why we are so excited about taking our programs to WhatsApp. So a large number of our users share a phone with a family member. So they don't have access to the phone throughout the day. And WhatsApp allows for asynchronous communication. So even if the woman has access to the phone for 30 minutes at the end of the day, she can catch up on her Kilkari messages. Also, WhatsApp allows us to use multimedia content, not just audio. So the content will be more engaging. Women will want to watch it multiple times, which will improve comprehension and lead to greater behavior change. And the third reason is that WhatsApp allows for two-way communication, and we want to provide mechanisms for better handholding and better support. So with this in mind, we started with a Kilkari WhatsApp offering. We just concluded a pilot in September. We enrolled about 500 participants in two Indian states, two Hindi-speaking Indian states, Haryana and Jharkhand. And these 500 participants were enrolled directly by health workers face-to-face. They were offered about 6 weeks of content, and we sent over 10,000 messages, of which more than 90% were read. And this is actually much, much better than performance on IVR, where we see average call answer rates of 60 to 65%, which means that a woman is almost 50% more likely to be exposed to a message if she's on WhatsApp compared to IVR. We also introduced two-way communication into our offering. We had some interactive messages built into the content calendar. And the response was phenomenal. So over 70% of users responded to at least one message. And the response rates for individual messages ranged from 35 to 60%. Not very surprisingly, the feedback messages had lower engagement, and the quiz questions and the games had the highest response rates. And I think the reason I said that this is phenomenal is because a large number of our users come from marginalized backgrounds. So women who have very limited literacy, very limited digital skills. We hadn't expected such high engagement rates.
Wow, 90% read rate. That's huge and amazing to learn. Thanks, Amita, for sharing those insights. I'm sure other community members they find it interesting too. Just a connecting question on that, Amrita. Can you expand on the type of content and resources that your service will be delivering to the users through WhatsApp?
Yeah. So for the pilot, we had the core service, which is the preventive care information that's sent out once or twice a week. This is state-specific information, which is relevant to the woman at that particular stage of pregnancy or infancy. We also have a calendar of interactive messages that reinforce key messages, right? So this is mostly quizzes and nudges with a few feedback questions thrown in. And the third resource we want to provide is a Q&A and handholding service, which will guide women through pregnancy and infancy.
Got it. So in the journey of developing the chat service for the pilot study and scaling it up, can you shed some light on some of the challenges that you encountered?
Yeah, so I think one of the first challenges we encountered was that of low literacy levels. So a very large number of our users, almost a third of our users, either have no schooling or just have a few years of schooling, which means they basically cannot read or write. And this we discovered fairly early through user research. So we had to make sure that we kept the text minimal. We used suitable emojis that they were familiar with. And we had to make sure that all the content could be navigated visually, right? So it was bright and visual enough that they did not have to read the accompanying text to know what a video or poster was about. After the pilot, we saw that while there were some users who wanted a higher frequency of messages, a large number of users did not check their WhatsApp every day. And they often had interruptions where they were, where they would run out of data towards the end of the month and would not refill their data or recharge their data for a few days, which could take up to a week. So when they connected to WhatsApp again, there were often multiple messages and they are not in the habit of scrolling up. So they would miss critical messages and only read the final message. So we are actively thinking of ways to address this in our final product. And the third one is probably a little more specific to our solution. We also saw that there were data delays. So because we rely on the pregnancy registry, we saw delays between the time the health worker enrolled a woman and her data officially came into us through the registry, right? And that meant that some of the information was already irrelevant to the woman. And I think this underscores the importance of working closely with health systems and system strengthening as well. So it's not just about the actual WhatsApp product, but also everything that happens in the back end.
Amazing. These are some peculiar insights. Thanks for sharing that, Amrita. Looking ahead, are there any exciting features or capabilities you plan to incorporate in your chat service in the future?
Yes, I've spoken about Kilkari so far, but we are also taking our frontline health worker training program, Mobile Academy, to WhatsApp. And we are currently doing user research to inform the design of the product. And I'm really excited about this. It might be one of the first learning products for health workers built entirely in WhatsApp. And I also talked about Q&A and handholding, right? We are exploring the use of LLMs across multiple programs to see how we can use large language models to improve navigation, to help with Q&A, potentially decision support as well.
Amazing. Before we open this conversation to the audience, just one last question, Amrita, around the insights, and if you'd like to share with other organizations that are just starting the process of building a chat service for their own organization, whether in health or other sector, what are like the key insights that you would share with them, or your takeaways?
Yeah, let me think about this. I'm reflecting on the process that we followed, and I think something that worked really well for us is making the entire innovation process user-centered, right, and human-centered. So we started with understanding our user and clearly articulating the problem we are trying to solve for them. So I think this is something that will hold everyone in good stead. Understand your user, understand their digital capabilities and preferences. How much text do they like? What's the right media format for them? Do they prefer typing? Do they prefer voice? What are their language preferences? That's the foundation of any chat service. I would also say it's important to define success upfront and set up the right metrics so you can make sure you're on the right track from day one. And having said that, I also want to say, sure, measure engagement through metrics. That's very, very important. But also make time to talk to users, look at individual chats, because often that's where the biggest insights will come from.
Amazing. Thank you for sharing those insights, Amrita. Greatly appreciate it. Now, we would like to turn our attention to our audience. If any of you have any questions, please don't hesitate to unmute your mic and ask the question, or type your question in the chat. Let me just scroll down and see if there are any questions. I see a question from Candice. In introducing bidirectional communication and asking for feedback to questions, do you act on the answers they provide, that is, escalate if they have any risk issues, or what is the exception on you, expectations on you, because they have disclosed this info?
Yeah, that's a great question. And we made sure that we had an onboarding, like a video onboarding experience that every user got when they signed up. And we told them that this is not a substitute for medical advice. This is a Government of India service. It's a and they can ask us questions, but in case of emergencies, they should reach out to their health worker or their doctor. So as soon as we got a question, we sent a response immediately saying, you will hear from somebody from our team in the next X hours. But in the meanwhile, if it's an emergency, please talk to your doctor. And someone from our team would call up, right? And we have medically trained members on our team. So at this scale, it was still possible to call, call women who sent us questions. At scale, we'll have to use either like decision trees or LLMs to answer questions. But for the pilot, we actually picked up the phone and called any woman who sent us questions. And we had, I think, close to, out of the 500 women, more than 100 women sent us messages. But a lot of the messages were just, thank you, this is great, etc. But we got about 40 to 50 questions and we had to call the women to address them.
Great. We have another question, actually two questions from Siddharth Chopra. First question is, how did you decide that you want to use the WhatsApp chat service?
Like I said, it was a very natural transition from the IVR program because we've conducted multiple surveys that show us that almost 65% of our user base uses WhatsApp. Right, and 80% of our user base has access to a smartphone. So not all the women own these phones, of course. About 80% have access to a smartphone, 65% use WhatsApp. YouTube usage rates were similar, but given the nature of the service, WhatsApp made more sense. And the second, you said there are two questions.
The second one is around the impact. How do you know that the engagement is leading to change in practices of users?
Yeah, this is exactly why we started with a pilot. So I didn't get into the details of the pilot, but we conducted a baseline survey and an endline survey, and we repeated the same questions. We wanted to understand knowledge, attitudes, practices around key health behaviors. So we did this before, and then the same questions were repeated after. And we trained health workers to carry out these surveys, so we could do this at a fairly large scale. We are still analyzing the numbers. So we know the engagement numbers, but of course, engagement is only meaningful if it leads to better comprehension and behavior change.
Great. Thanks, Amita. I guess there are no more questions on the chat, but if anyone wants to ask a question, they can unmute yourself and ask the question. Cool. I think there are no more questions for now. Thanks, Amrita, for actually there is one now. We have some time to take that one as well. This is a question from Orlando Vincent. How do you measure better comprehension or behavior change?
Yeah. So we had 6 weeks of content and two messages per week, right? So we covered 12 health topics. I think it was actually 8 health topics with some repetition. So for example, the importance of regular antenatal checkups. So we recommend 4 antenatal checkups. Anemia is a major public health challenge in India. So there were multiple messages on anemia, maternal nutrition, iron and folic acid tablets. We had a message about risk factors in pregnancy. There was one about family planning. So there are some desired behaviors and some like desired knowledge points. So we quizzed them about these before they were exposed to the WhatsApp product. That, do you know this? How important do you think this aspect is? How many times have you gone to see your doctor, right? So understanding knowledge, attitudes, and practices, and then repeating the same questions after 6 weeks of WhatsApp content.
Great. Thank you, Amrita. Thank you for addressing all the questions today. Appreciate your time and partnership with us. And we are excited what's next for Arman in coming months. Thank you.
Aturn has been an excellent partner all through this journey, and we look forward to scaling this product with you.
Likewise, Amita. Thank you very much. Now I would like to hand over to Pepa. Over to you, Pepa.
Thanks, Manish, and thanks so much, Amrita. Actually, earlier this week, Gustav and I were having our Tuesday morning coffee and egg roll down the street here and chatting about how amazing it is that individuals within organizations really drive projects forward. And Amrita, you're one of those people that we've seen an incredible change and a positive drive towards the next phase of Kilkari, and we are super excited about it. And also in the accelerator over the last 8 weeks, we had a whole cohort of more than 20 drivers that are pushing these types of projects forward. And I think for all of those of you who are on this call today, you know, there's that saying that, you know, individuals are the only ones that can change the world. And, you know, each one of you are doing such important work to drive important work forward. And we all need to work together. I mean, Amrita mentioned that you're working with partnerships, community partnerships on the ground, that you've got big partnerships with the government to get these things off the ground. I think in all of these really successful, really scalable solutions, it's never just one organization. It's a couple of drivers and a couple of organizations that are collaborating to pull these things off. And we cannot wait to see you surpass the 40 million on WhatsApp as you go forward over the next couple of months and years together. And I just want to say to the whole community again, if there's anything we can support you on, if you're looking into crisis response or humanitarian work around Gaza at the moment, or in Afghanistan or Nepal, where there have been recent earthquakes, please do not hesitate to reach out to us. The TURN team is always here on standby and always working really hard to build new tools to make these things even quicker to deploy in these scenarios. So thank you very much. One last thing, another driver in our team, I just want to say a big shout out to Ricardo. You saw a lot of stuff launching over the last, in this town hall, a lot of new UI. And although it's been a team effort, the driver on that side of the new UI is Ricardo, who joined our team only, feels like you've been here forever, Ricardo, but it's only been a couple of months. And I just want to say a big thank you to the huge impact you're having on the TURN product and making it easier for all of the organizations using TURN. So thank you so much for all your hard work. And that's a wrap for today. So thank you so much, everyone, for joining. We'll see you again in November. I can't believe it'll be the second to last town hall of the year. We know you're all busy, so we'll see you in a month. Thank you so much.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.